so on. So the long-winded nature of much of his writing may be due less to his lack of literary skill, which was enviable, and more to the way in which the material was originally intended to be consumed. He began a large commentary on the Torah. It was interrupted several times in his lifetime because of his flight from one country to another. One of the most moving passages, he lost most of his commentary on the book of Dvarim for about 30 years. And then when he was fleeing from one country to another, he ended up in the island of Corfu. He came across a manuscript copy that someone had made, and he had a tremendous simcha because he realized that much of his early work was not lost, and in fact he continued and completed at that point. So what ends up happening with him politically, as we see quite often with Jews in this situation, it's Joseph once again, right? The problem that Joseph had was, or the problem that the Jews had, was that a new pharaoh came up, a new pharaoh, who knew not Joseph, right? Rav says it was a different person, and Shmuel says it was the same person, but he forgot about Joseph. And this is exactly what happened to Abravanel. His primary supporter was a king named Alfonso V, who died in his early 40s as a result of the plague. The bubonic plague was still quite active in Spain in the 15th century. It broke out in the early 14th century, but for the next 200 years it continued to scourge much of Europe. And when Alfonso IV died, his successor was not at all the same kind of king. And this new king had, and by the way, I would tell you that king's name, but I'm not sure how to pronounce it. Maybe we have some Spanish speakers here. It's spelled J-A-O. Is that how?
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 How? But if it's the
village,
Jow.
It's okay. So, but it would be in this region. Would you say it with the H or with the?
Here.
Here.
Yeah? The Castilian J. Would be.
J. Okay. Yeah. I remember. I'll tell you a funny story for a second. They'll cut this out in the Torah Cafe version. But when I first moved down to Florida, we got lost, and we got off the. We got our car at the Orlando, you know, we drove the car train down, we drove down, and we were supposed to drive down the turnpike to Golden Glades, but we kept going all the way down south off I-95, and we were on US 1, when finally we said, you know, we probably passed it, let's stop at a gas station and ask directions. I, of course, being male, did not want to ask for directions. I figured we'd hit the ocean and then we'd turn around, but my wife said, no, we have to ask for directions. So I went into the gas station, and there's a Hispanic woman there, and I got on, this was, I think, before cell phones, or at least we didn't have a cell phone, and I got on the payphone, and I called our real estate agent to get directions. And he said to me, well, where are you now? And I said, well, I don't know. And I asked the woman behind the counter, I said, what street is this out here? And she says to me, Jew S1. And I said, what? She says, Jew S1. And so I said to him, I don't know. They call this place Jews 1. What kind of street is that? Jews 1. You know. But anyways, yes, we found the home. Okay, so his successor was quite tyrannical, and to make things worse, Abravanel was associated with a noble house called the House of Braganza, and these were, of course, the principal rivals of the new king. And so all of a sudden, Abravanel went from being one of the most trusted and respected officials in the court to being persona non grata. He was summoned to appear before the king, which probably would have been a terrible moment, where he would have maybe been stripped of all his wealth and his position, perhaps thrown in jail. And Abravanel got the idea that this was going to be a dangerous invitation, and so he decided rather to flee, and he left Spain heading west towards Portugal. He couldn't simply cross the border. He had to travel a little bit north and then move and get into the country a little bit later, but he realized that this was the end of his prominence at the time. He managed to cross the border, and amazingly, afterward, of course, Spain, he was absolutely correct that this is what they were planning for him. They sentenced him to death in absentia, a decree that would remain in effect for the rest of his life, even though he would end up later working for the Spanish crown again. During this time, when he was separated from his wife and children, living in exile in Portugal, he had an incredible rush of creative energy. And he produced, it's amazing, about 400,000 words of biblical commentary in 5 months. If you think about 400,000 words, let's see, 20,000 words is something like 100 pages. So 400,000 would be like, no, sorry, 20,000 words is about 100 pages. So 200,000 would be 1,000 pages. So he produced about 2,000 pages of material in 5 months, which is an astounding literary output, all publishable, of course, and all utilized today. Especially fascinating are his commentaries on the early books of the Bible after Devarim, which deal with, for example, the kingship of Saul and the split of the kingdom of Judah and Israel, and his insight into the political structures of the day was absolutely fascinating, undoubtedly colored by his own experience in the royal houses of Spain. Netanyahu, in his biography, speaks to this influence of political experience, and also notes the wide exposure that Abarbanel clearly had to many Christian classics that were circulating in the day, including Thomas Aquinas. So he managed, nevertheless, He managed actually to get back to Spain, despite He fled Portugal to Spain. Thank you. No one corrected me. Torah Cafe, please remove all those things when you edit it. But he's leaving Portugal into Spain. So now here he is in Spain. He has the death warrant on his head in Portugal. And in Spain, he once again rises to authority. He likely is the principal financier of the court. And he does this primarily by advising Ferdinand and Isabella, the king and queen who would later expel the Jews from Spain, advising them how to finance their wars with nearby kingdoms. He is incredibly successful in this regard, and he is allowed to bring his family to Spain with him at this point. And then he moves into a new type of industry, one that was tried and true for many Jews in Europe and later would become the downfall of the Jews in Eastern Europe, as we'll talk about in 2 weeks. He engages in tax farming. What is tax farming? Tax farming is a type of economic tax collection method which works in a corporate society, meaning works in a type of feudal society where you have people divided by classes on a very large scale. This is tax season, and we all know how they collect taxes in America. The government knows each of us individually. We have personal income tax. Unless we are dependents of someone else, we all have to fill out our own individual taxes, and we all have to individually pay to the government. We can also file jointly if we're married and so on, but that's about it. The government deals with us all as individuals. That's something that only really develops after the French Revolution of the 18th century. In the medieval period, that was way too detailed for the medieval monarchs to handle. And so they say, okay, all you peasants have to produce so much money. All you nobles have to provide so much money, and so on. And they would not, you know, they wouldn't care which person paid more than another. They said, we want, at the end of the year, April 15th, we want so much money in our treasury. So how would they actually achieve it is typically they would hire tax farmers who would be quite often Jews, who are given a certain amount of territory and told that you are to collect so much money from the local population in any way that you see fit. So that would include, for example, a tax on grain production. It could include a tax on the usage of bridges or tolls, hunting regions, orchards. It could include a tax on a poll tax, tax on individual people. Whatever way they could figure out to collect those taxes, that was their job. It was called tax farming because whatever they were able to collect beyond what was requested by the king was their profit. And so this worked very well for Jews because here they are a separate population entirely, and they move into a region where they have, you know, a large, let's say, peasant or serf population, and the local nobleman says, I cannot be bothered collecting money from all of these people, but I figure they're good for 6,000 gold coins, so you have a whole year to go in there and get me 6,000 gold coins. And if the Jews would collect 7,000 or 8,000, then that extra 1,000 or 2,000 gold coins would then go back to the Jewish community to support yeshivot, day schools, mikvahs, Chinese restaurants, all those kinds of things. It was a very lucrative profession for Jews. It involved a very little, you know, physical labor. It did not endear them to the local population, who often saw them as, you know, tax collectors, ultimately, that's what they were. In some cases, as in Eastern Europe, the Jews were granted certain monopolies, such as the monopoly of alcohol production, propinatia, which allowed them to be the sole manufacturers and distributors of alcohol. And there's a lot of other factors like this that means that the general population from time to time would have a certain amount of resentment against the Jewish people engaged in this activity. At the same time, the Jews were protected because the king wanted to see them succeed. And so if you were taking out your frustrations on the Jewish tax collector, you were really taking out your frustrations on the king. So the king wanted to make sure that the Jews were successful, and he would back them with his army to make sure that people submitted to the Jews' will. One more detail I wanted to mention. Well, I had another detail. This worked great for the Jews, except for a couple of possibilities. First of all, if the noblemen were too greedy, now I remember. Shimon Dubno, a great historian, we'll speak about him later on in the series, he referred to tax farming in such a way that the Jews were like a sponge that were dipped into the peasantry by the noblemen, and then they were squeezed dry for whatever they could suck out of the population there. And it was definitely a kind of a precarious model for the Jews, but potentially very lucrative. In terms of the this model working, it's great so long as there is a very fine balance struck between what the peasants will tolerate paying and what the noblemen will tolerate accepting. When the noblemen demand too much, or the peasants get too rebellious, then the Jews are in a terrible place, and they usually have either popular uprisings, such as the 17th century uprisings in Ukraine, or you have expulsions, where the noblemen say, you know what, I put too much pressure on my peasantry, I'm extremely unpopular right now, or also quite possibly, I myself owe the Jews a lot of money. It's more expedient to simply expel the Jews and start with a clean slate, even if I have to, as the French did, invite them back 20 years later, three times in a row. Because you owe money to the Jews, so you expel them, but you need them to work the tax farming system, so you invite them back. Then you borrow money from them, you owe too much money from them, you kick them out again, and so on.
Well, this is. At that time, the Jewish community, let's say it like this, worked perfectly for the Jewish needs. They were in the time that they were created, they did have a community service for everybody that helped in that moment also. So it was also divided by that fine line up to when I can, how much can I pull these strings?
Exactly.
But in the same time, protected by what the government needed, they were also protected as a community.
Yeah, it provided for the insular nature of Jewish society, because you couldn't exactly make friends with all the peasants. Yeah, absolutely. Please.
There's a fairly long history of this expulsion of Jews, a temporary uplift in the economic conditions as they confiscate all of the possessions.
Correct.
And then, of course, the economy begins to dip because they lose the contribution of the Jews.
Right. There's a one-time bonus
after the expulsion of York. It's a long history of this, and then inviting them back. So it wasn't just limited to Spain.
Absolutely. Very, very true. Please, Estebel.
The last line there.
Yeah.
His role was the grantor of the farms, or he was grantee, the grantee of the farms?
He was the grantee. He was the tax farmee, No, he was a tax farmer. He was given control. Okay, you farm the taxes over here.
Okay.
Which means you collect
other
as much.
Ones too.
Yes.
Okay.
Absolutely. Okay. So now let's talk a little bit about the Inquisition, which is a major element to this story. The Inquisition is basically a Spanish institution that spread beyond Spain that was directed at searching out heresy among Catholics. One of the widely held misapprehensions is the notion that the Inquisition was directed against Jews. It was not actually directed against Jews, and in fact, Jews were to a certain degree immune from the Inquisition per se. What it was directed at were the so-called conversos, or the derogatory term Marranos, those Jews who had, sometime prior, perhaps after the 1391 pogroms, accepted Christianity in an outward fashion, but did not actually believe what they were behaving. And the church in Spain was very concerned about rooting out these false Christians, so to speak. They actually had a distinct term for them, new Christians, and you could retain that distinction for three generations. One of the great scholars of the Holocaust, Raoul Hilberg, introduces his magnum opus, The Destruction of European Jews, by comparing the Nazi Nuremberg laws to the 15th century Spanish laws regarding these so-called new Christians. Because there was really a kind of a blood-based racist attitude that you don't see anywhere else in Europe, really, until the 19th century, that discriminated against these new Christians because the Spaniards felt that they weren't actually believing Christians. And the truth is, they were right. The so-called conversos, or crypto-Jews, were definitely still practicing Jewish services in secret. They were highly endogamous, meaning they're only marrying other conversos. They weren't marrying regular Spaniards, for the most part. And they were basically creating that kind of Sephardic niche of, well, everybody outside thinks we're Christian, but everybody who's important knows that we're actually Jewish. And they could do this quite comfortably for decades or centuries, as it turns out. There are crypto Jews that are still detected in the American Southwest, even well into the early 20th century. Mr. Rodriguez, does it go further than that, the 20th century? It goes right up to the 21st century even then. It looks like it's an amazing phenomenon. So the purpose of the Inquisition was that the church in Spain was trying to root out these false Christians, the Jews who had converted to Christianity, but did not actually believe what they were saying. The Jews technically speaking, had a false sense of security because they felt like, well, you know, the Inquisition isn't bothering us. As long as we keep to our traditions and we openly practice as Jews, then we have nothing to worry about. That turned out to be a false sense of security, but nevertheless, much of the bulk of the animus was directed at these new Christians, including even old Christians who were suspected of Judaizing, of being tempted by Jewish values, and so on. Please.
I was going to say, and now these crypto Jews were very successful because they had all the restrictions removed from them.
Yeah.
And so the Christian business people were very resentful of them because they could practice all of the trades and at the same time still not be fully Christian in their mind. And as a matter of fact, I think that the Jewish communities were actually very supportive of at the beginning of the Inquisition because they felt these are people who betrayed us and let them be punished.
Yeah, and that was certainly not the best moment of Jewish unity, I think. Did I tell you the joke about the guy who wants to join the country club? Yes, you're right. Well, Stephen, you remember all my jokes. Do you mind if I tell it again? Okay, the joke goes like this. So in the, you know, for those of you who are younger, you know that up until... It was Mr. Schwartz in the original? Okay, that was Mr. Schwartz. Okay, so up until, you know, really... you know, it's ancient history for most of you, but until the 1990s, a lot of these clubs, even here in Miami, were so-called restricted, right? You could only join if you're Gentile clientele. And it was no problem with this. I joked about the 1990s. There were some that were still like this in the 90s, but they were openly like this until a great film came out called Gentleman's Agreement that really turned around the way people thought about these things right at the end of World War II. But at any rate, up until the 1940s, you know, Jews could not get into a place like this, it would be forbidden, ridiculous. And hotels, forget about it. So anyways, the joke goes that there's this Jewish guy who wants to belong to this restricted country club. And so he goes to the membership director and he says, listen, these are my assets. I have these boats and these apartment buildings. And I really think that I belong in your crowd here in the Flaming Crosses Country Club. And the membership director says, you know, listen, what's your name, Cohen? You know, I can't help you because, you know, we're a very exclusive club and you can only join, you know, if you have a sponsor. And I don't think you're going to find a sponsor. And he says, well, who's on your membership? I'm sure I know someone. So he says, look, here's the membership list. Shows it to him. Cohen looks down the list and he sees someone named Schwartz. And so he says, oh, I know this guy. I'll go talk to my friend Schwartz. So he leaves, he goes, he knocks on the door of Schwartz, and Schwartz opened the door, and Cohen says to him, Shalom Aleichem, Reb Yid, listen, I wanted to join the Flaming Crosses Country Club, and I need a sponsor. So I was thinking, maybe, you know, you're a Jew, I'm a Jew, you could help me out. So Mr. Schwartz looks him in the eye and says, listen, Mr. Cohen was your name? Let me tell you something. I am a Presbyterian, and my father was a Presbyterian. And my grandfather, Oliver Shalom, was also a Presbyterian. Okay. All right, so let's go on. The Inquisition. Now, so you have this scenario where the Inquisition is directed primarily at these new Christians, these conversos, and Jews who were like remaining within the traditional Jewish community felt largely immune to the pressures that the church were exerting. And even though there were some really distinct warning signs, the edict of expulsion took them completely by surprise. A couple of the expulsions that are significant, Andalusia and Aragon in the 1480s, some really nasty trials and executions that occurred in a few places, including a blood libel in 1490 and 91. But the traditional Jewish approach was, you know what, these things,